everyone, brothers and sisters. Hallelujah. Thank you for coming tonight. I know for some of us it's a sacrifice to come out to Bible study. Sometimes we find it difficult because we're right in the middle of the week and we just want the week to end. It's been a hard 2 to 3 days. It's been exhausting. But you came here in your fatigue. You came here, I hope, hungry. I hope, thirsting. To hear from the Lord. So that's what I'd like to be a conduit tonight. So I'm just going to ask you to have a seat and relax. Don't want you standing all this time. Just so you know why I am ministering tonight, Pastor Joe was planning on ministering tonight, and you know his outside job, he handles a lot of different properties. And one of them have a water main break or something like that. And it was far away, farther than he would be able to go there, fix it, and come back on time. So I just found out a couple of hours ago I'm teaching tonight. That's why I'm here. That's why he is not here tonight. But I'm sure he would have been super excited about his message. And I think that I am too. So let's begin with something that the Lord had on my heart that I'd like to kind of share with you. Let me ask you some rhetorical questions, and you don't have to share what comes to mind, but I just want to ask them out, and then you just kind of figure out in your mind what comes to mind when you hear the questions. What does love look like? What does love look like? Does it look like a father grabbing his two daughters and holding them and caressing them? And or is it, you know, that father carrying his son? Or maybe it's the mother just holding the daughter. Is that what love looks like? Is love just romance? That romance that you see on the movie screens, or the romance that you read in the books, or the romance of the romantic comedies you might watch and stuff like that? Or is it just something that's left to chance? Is it only for the lucky people? Is it only for the beautiful people? Is it just momentary bliss? There's a song that says, well, it's a lot more than this. A lot more than this. If all of life comes down to love, then tell me, what does love look like? So what does love look like? If we look in the scriptures and you have your Bible with you, I'll tell you to turn to 1 John chapter 5, verse 3. It says in 1 John, not the Gospel of John, but 1 John, for this is the love of God, that we keep his commandments. And his commandments are not grievous. Now, you don't have to answer my next question, but was that the first thing that came to your mind when I asked you, what does love look like? Was that the first thing? Oh, it's keeping his commandments. That's what it is. Yeah. No, yeah, I doubt that. But then he says in 2 John 1:6, he says it again in his next letter. He says, and this is love, that we walk after his commandments. This is the commandment, that as ye have heard from the beginning, ye should walk in it. So love, according to the scriptures, and I've only given you two, I could have given you a lot more, but I'm trying to just narrow down our point for tonight. Love seems to be connected in when we're talking about in context the love of God or loving God. It seems to be connected in context to walking in his commandments. And we don't really think of that initially. We think of loving God. Maybe you thought like John the disciple resting his head on the breast of Jesus. Maybe that was the love that you thought of. But according to the scriptures, love looks like keeping his commandments, walking in his commandments. So you probably heard of a question or a popular kind of message that a lot of churches might throw out there. And the idea is, you know, well, just come as you are. Just come into the church building. You know, God loves you just as you are. So my question to you is, does God love you just as you are? Or is that some fancy cliche that's kind of spread throughout all of Christianity and churchendom? Does he just love you just as you are? If he loved us just as we were, would he change anything? Would he change anything if he loved us just as we were? Because if he loved us just as we were, well, why would I need to change anything? So I want you to consider Revelation 3:19. He was speaking to the seven churches. And he said in Revelation 3:19, as many as I love, I rebuke and chasten. But it doesn't end there. He says, be zealous, therefore, and repent. Well, that kind of answers my question, because if he loves us just as I am, why would he rebuke me? Why would he chasten me? Why would he desire of me to be zealous, to repent and change, if he loved me just as I am? So I read those scriptures and I think, well, wow, if I really want to study the love of God, I need to take it in its entirety. I need to take, you know, not only the romantic kind of love that's just in my mind, or maybe in my wife's mind, or in the lady's mind, we have this romantic idea of love. And yet when we read the scriptures and we get right down to the brass tacks, it's so demanding, his love. Why is his love so demanding? Why is it so conditional, if you will? Why doesn't he just love me the way that I am? Why doesn't he love you just the way that you are? Why is his love expecting so much from me? Why is it expecting so much from you? Be zealous, repent. If I love you, I rebuke you. If I love you, I chasten you. John 21. Jesus had already resurrected. He was walking, and the disciples were fishing on the sea, and they really didn't know what to do yet. They were just kind of floundering. He had already resurrected, and they were kind of directionless. So they went back to what they normally did before they met Jesus. What? Fish. They went back to fishing. But they saw him from a distance. And Peter knew who it was and was so excited to see him, even after he had denied him three times, and there was a lot of grief and guilt and shame that he was going through. But he was still excited when he saw Jesus. And it says in John 21, verses 15, so when they had dined, because they came to shore, they dined with Jesus, Jesus said to Simon, Simon, son of Jonas, do you love me more than these? And Simon said unto him, yeah, Lord, you know that I love you. That's what he said. You know that I love you. And then Jesus responded to him, well, then feed my lambs. And so he said unto Simon again a second time, he said, Simon, son of Jonas, do you love me? He said unto him, yes, Lord, you know that I love you. And Jesus said again to him, feed my sheep. He saith unto him a third time, Simon, son of Jonas, Do you love me? And Peter was grieved. Can you imagine? He told him before the cock crows, you're going to deny me three times. But I prayed for you that your faith would not fail. And when you get converted and you come back, he said, strengthen the brethren. And so Jesus is coming right back to that point that happened days before. I can't tell you how many days, because I don't know. He walked with them for about 40 days after he resurrected. I don't know what days it was that he was there. But he brought him back to that moment where he told them, you're going to deny me three times, but I prayed for you that your faith would not fail, and that when you return, you need to strengthen the brethren. And now he's coming right back to that point. Do you love me, Simon? Do you love me, Simon? Then feed my sheep. So he said unto him a third time, do you love me? And Peter was grieved. He said unto him a third time, lovest thou me? Because Jesus asked him, do you love me? And he said unto him, Lord, you know everything. You know all things. You know that I love you. That's all he could say. And Jesus said to him, well, then feed my sheep. What kind of love, when we read through the scripture, what kind of love is it? Go back to 1 John in chapter 3, because John talks about this love again. And it's not surprising to me, because John was the one that laid his head upon the breast of Jesus while Jesus spoke and taught to the rest of the disciples, and he was just there listening to the heartbeat of God as he spoke. And he said, and John was the one that wrote, behold, what manner of love the Father has bestowed upon us, that we should be called the sons of God. How many of y'all think yourself so highly that, yeah, I'm a son of God naturally? If y'all look in the mirror long enough at all of your imperfections and all of your weaknesses and all of the failures that you've had in the past, the very last thing that comes to mind is that you are a son of God. But what manner of love the Father bestowed upon us, that in spite of all that, I call you my son. I call you my son. And the world doesn't know that. Because the world doesn't know him. The world is not called his sons. And if you look at Hebrews chapter 12, verses 5 through 10, well, we believe him to be Paul, the author of Hebrews, so I'm just going to go with that for right now. We're not going to battle over that right now. But the author of Hebrews says in verse 12 verse 5 of chapter 12, and ye have forgotten the exhortation which speaketh unto you as unto children, my son, despise not the chastening of the Lord, nor faint when thou art rebuked of him. Peter, remember Peter? You're going to deny me before the cock crows three times. And then here's the Lord. Did you notice how he was kind of rebuking, chastening him, but directing him? Do you love me? Really, Simon? Really? And every single time, feed my sheep. Feed my sheep. I'm directing you. Feed my sheep. Well, what was love according to the scriptures? Keep his commandments. And so Jesus was speaking directly to Simon. When you get converted, when you come back to me, when you really desire and love me, feed my sheep. It says in verse 6, for whom the Lord loveth, he chasteneth, and he scourgeth every son whom he receiveth. This is part and parcel with your relationship with God. As a child of God, you need to expect that you at times in your life are going to be chastened. You're going to be rebuked. You might be scourged. You might get that fanny, or that paddle on your fanny, or that little stick on your thigh, and wow, okay, and you start learning obedience. It says furthermore in verse 7, if you endure the chastening, God dealeth with you as with sons. For what son is he whom the father chasteneth not? But if ye be without chastisement, whereof all are partakers, then you are bastards, and you are not sons. If it's not my child, I'm not going to be chastening that child. I'm going to be like disciplining them and doing that. No, this is not my child. The father is supposed to chasten his own child. And the father, according to the scriptures, the father's heart in chastening his child is out of love. It's out of love. It's not out of anger. It's not out of wrath. It's out of, I love you so much. So we go back to that idea. Does he love me just the way that I am? Because he keeps disciplining, putting me through different trials and tribulations so that my heart would be channeled back toward him. But that's what love does. When we reach out and we want to reach somebody that's kind of lost along the way, we're not trying to correct them out of anger or out of spite or out of you imbecile, you idiot, you stupid moron, what's wrong with you? No, I don't want you to suffer for these decisions that you're going. I don't want you to suffer because of the direction you're going. I'm just trying to get you back on track, that's all. I'm not trying to control you. I'm not into that. And neither is the Lord. He's not into that. But he sees where this direction that you're headed toward, and he's trying to redirect you back onto the pathway that is going to lead you to eternal life. So he says in verse 9, furthermore, we have had fathers of our flesh, and they corrected us, and we gave them reverence. Our fathers, if they were, you know, truly fathers and they truly loved us, they corrected us, they disciplined us, and we didn't like it at the time. But you know what it caused to have a healthy fear for our father, or a healthy fear for a mother if it was that person, or maybe it was a grandmother, maybe it was an aunt, and we had a healthy fear for them. And so that's good. Shall we not much rather be in subjection unto the Father of spirits and live? If we subjected ourselves to our own earthly parents and the discipline and the rebuke that they gave us, how much more should we not do the same with our Lord, our Heavenly Father, and live? Notice that word, and live. Because it's the chastisement of the Lord that brings about your change and direction and path so that you can live eternally. So in verse 10, for verily for a few days chastened us after their own pleasure. That was our earthly parents, you know, for a few days. And then we kind of grew up and we went out of the house and there's no more chastening from them. I mean, they might kind of rebuke us and correct us verbally. But, you know, that discipline part, that hurtful, painful, physical part, that's probably not going to happen anymore. But he, for our profit, he chastens us for our profit, it says, that we might be partakers of his holiness. The love of God that brings about that chastening and that scourging and that correction and that rebuke in our lives is because he wants us to be holy. So I read that and I say, whoa, his love demands holiness. Well, before I met Christ, was I holy? Before you got born again, were you holy? So this idea that, well, he just loves us just the way we are. I don't know about that. That's not what the scriptures are teaching me as I'm reading them to you. I think of Genesis 17:1. Abram was 90 years old. 99, excuse me. He was 99 years old, and the Lord appeared to Abram and said to him, I am Almighty God. Walk before me and be thou perfect. What? Be perfect. Yeah, that's what it says. Be perfect. In Deuteronomy 18:13, thou shalt be perfect with the Lord thy God. He says in 1 Kings 8:61, let your heart therefore be perfect with the Lord our God. Well, how so? To walk in his statutes, to keep his commandments. There it is again, as this day. And now I come back to 1 John 4:18. There is no fear in love. Perfect love casteth out fear, because fear brings torment. He that feareth is not made perfect in love. But whoever keeps his word, in 1 John 2:5, in him verily is the love of God, what? Perfected. And hereby we know that we are in him. So his love demands holiness. As I read these scriptures, his love demands us to be perfect, or demands perfection, which is really only found in him. It is an inherent property of God's love to bring to completeness those whom he loves. That was a lot to say. Let me repeat that again. Please listen, because this is important. It is an inherent property of God's love to bring to completeness, to perfection, to holiness, to purity, those whom he loves. That's what God's love is supposed to do in us. It's bring us to completion and perfection. So this idea that God loves us just the way we are, I don't know. I'm pretty convinced that that's not really the case. That's just some fancy cliche we say because we want to bring people into our church, and, you know, we're going to be totally accepting of you, and God just loves you just the way you are. Well, not according to the scriptures. Okay, God loves you so much that he is not willing to leave you just the way you are. You think about that. God loves you so much, he will not let you stay in the state that you're in before you found him. He's got a plan for you. He's got a plan for you, a plan for good, not to harm you, to give you a future and a hope. And this plan of his that he wants to bring about in your life is so far and away above and beyond your imaginations for yourself and the conceptions for yourself that you can't even sit back and have a dream about it if it's not the Lord showing you what plan he actually has for you. But it's definitely not to stay the way that you are. So what does 1 Corinthians 2:9 says? You know, hey, it's written. Eye has not seen, ear has not heard, nor has entered into the heart of man. You couldn't even try to imagine what God has in store for you, because you still wouldn't come up with it. But it's not even in your heart, the things that God has prepared for those that love him. The love of God is committed to completing a work in your life. He is sold out to complete a work in your life that you can't even imagine. He is ready to go and has already gone to hell to do something in your life that you can't even imagine. So Romans 5:5 says, you know what? Hope doesn't disappoint. Because the love of God has been poured out in our hearts. How? By the Holy Spirit who was given to us. Say it again. The love of God has been poured out in our hearts by the Holy Spirit. Well, what is this love of God demanding? What is it committed to doing? To making us holy, to making us pure, to making us perfect. He is completely committed to making you something you cannot even imagine yourself to become. Hallelujah. Thank God. Thank God. Do you remember there was a king of Salem in the old covenant? King of Salem, his name was Melchizedek. And Melchizedek was not only the king of Salem, he was also identified as the priest of the Most High God, Melchizedek. And it says in Hebrews 6:20 that Jesus was made a high priest after the order of Melchizedek. If you didn't know, King of Salem is the king of peace. Salem was peace. And he was the priest of the Most High God. Well, if you read Revelation 17:14 or you read Revelation 19:16, it says of Jesus that he is the Lord of all lords. He is the King of all kings. And it says in Revelation 1:6 and 5:10, it says it in two different places, that he has made us kings and priests. We're following after him. And if we look to Jesus, we already get a glimpse of what our destiny in him is going to be. We're already see where we're headed towards. Where is this spirit of God that was poured out in our hearts? It is the love of God. Where is it directing me towards? Well, just look to Jesus. He's directing you. He's making you. He's molding you. He's fashioning you to be a king and a priest. And then he's going to be the king of all kings. And he's going to be the Lord of all lords, or rulers, if you will. And he's going to be the high priest of all the high priests. Like Aaron was the high priest, but he had his sons under him and they were priests as well. So 1 Peter 2:9 gives us the revelation. Hey, you are a chosen generation. You are a royal priesthood. You are a holy nation, a peculiar people, and that you should show forth the praises of him that has called you out of darkness into his marvelous light. Jesus left us an example. We may not realize that, but I'm going to show you. Jesus left us an example that we should follow in his footsteps. You can read that in 1 Peter 2:21. Jesus left an example that we should follow in his footsteps. Now let me tell you about Jesus. In Hebrews 2:9, it says, we see Jesus. He was made a little lower than the angels. Why? That he might suffer death. That he might be crowned with glory and honor. And that he, by the grace of God, should taste death for every man. That's why. Jesus was made a little lower than the angels for a very specific purpose. To taste death for every man, that he may be crowned with glory and honor. In Hebrews 2:17, it says, furthermore, wherefore in all things it behooved him to be made like unto his brethren, that he might be a merciful and faithful high priest in things pertaining to God, to make reconciliation for the sins of the people. He did something on our behalf that needed to be done, because if it had not been done, he would never be able to fulfill what he wanted to do in us. This sin aspect had to be dealt with. He had to taste death for every man. He had to become the reconciliation for us all in order that he might be able to pour out his spirit on our flesh and then do a work within us that is progressing day by day. It says our inner man is renewed day by day. It's being conformed more and more into his image day by day as we learn to yield. As we learn to surrender, as we learn to walk in his commandments, as we learn to subjugate ourselves to the leading of his spirit. But then it also says in Hebrews 5:8-9, though he were a son, again, he left us a trail to follow. We need to follow in his footsteps. What was his trail? Though he were a son, yet he learned, anybody know the word? He learned obedience. That's my wife right there. He learned obedience. That's following in Jesus' footsteps. If he obeyed the Father, we need to follow in those footsteps. See, he was just showing us the pathway. He was blazing the trail so that we would see the trail and say, oh, okay, that's the way I need to go. And being, here's that word. Remember that demand of the love of God. He wanted us to be perfect. Be thou perfect. Be thou perfect. Well, here it says again. And being made perfect. Being made complete. Being made whole. He became the author of eternal salvation unto all men that do what? Obey him. Oh, man. I'm telling you, that love of God is demanding. It demands obedience. You want to be holy, you want to be pure, you want to have all of these things in your life, these promises of God. It demands your obedience. So what is the manifestation and the expression of his love? 1 John, back to 1 John 9 and 10. It says, in this was manifested, was revealed the love of God toward us. How did he express and manifest and reveal his love toward us? Because that God sent his only begotten son into the world that we might live through him. Here is love. Not that we love God. That's not where it's at. Herein is the love of God, that he first loved us. That while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. He came to this earth to take care of all the sins of the world, and not any one of us was crying out for him at that time. Not any one of us was seeking after God. He did it before we ever turned our attention to the Lord God. It was because he came and put himself on the cross and shed his blood for our sins and put that crown of thorns on his head and ripped his back to shreds that we can look at him with eyes of appreciation, of gratitude, of thankfulness. Because it would be self-condemning to look at the love of God and turn your back on everything that he did for you. You would be deserving and worthy of death to do that. He loved us and he sent his son to be a propitiation, meaning he had to pay the penalty for us. So in 1 John 3:16 it says, hereby we perceive the love of God because, very simply, he laid down his life for us. In Acts 20:28 it even says that God purchased the church with his own blood. Not someone else's blood. He didn't send somebody else. He did it with his own blood. So take heed unto yourselves and to all the flock over which the Holy Ghost has made you overseers to feed the church of God which he hath purchased with his own blood. Again, remember, this was found out about a few hours ago that I was going to teach. So I asked, I actually had plans to show it on the video, but we couldn't do that. So I asked someone to sing a song that I just want you to listen to. I wish I could have put the words up there, but if they sing it clearly, I'm pretty sure they will. I want you to just receive the ministry of what this song has to share with you, and then I'll come back and finish the message in the closing. But the title of the song is Arms Wide Open.
What does love look like? question I've been asking of you. Once believed in love was romance, just a chance.
Love me, you shall love.
I just imagine our Lord hanging on that cross, his arms wide open. He's totally naked. They don't say that, but when they crucified you, when the Romans crucified you, they crucified you totally naked. He was bare before all men there. He looked at his mother. He looked at the other women that were there with his mother. He looked them right in their eyes. He was saying, this is love. This right here is love. And he bled. He was broken and he was bruised. He was battered. Could barely breathe. Could barely kick up his legs to get an ounce of breath. And they pierced him with a sword in his side. And blood and water came out and dripped down his leg and down to the cross and down into the earth. And this was love. This was a picture of love. And that's why that love is so demanding. It is so demanding of us. Because Romans 12 says that we present our bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable unto God. And it's a reasonable, it is a reasonable reaction, a reasonable response to the love that was shed abroad on that cross when he died for our sins, our sins. It was our fault. I didn't have to be a Jew of that day saying, crucify him. I didn't have to be a Roman centurion staking the nails in his, through his hands into the cross. Because that wasn't why he died. He died for my sin. He died for your sin. It's why he went to the cross. How do you look at a man that does that for you when you never asked him to, and then turn your back as if it was nothing? We can't do that. Do you love me? He said on the cross, do you love me? Because if you love me, you'll follow my commandments. You'll abide in my statutes. You'll abide in my word. You will not turn to the left. You will not turn to the right. You will stay in the pathway of holiness that I've called you to. Righteousness that I've called you to. Purity that I've called you to. Perfection that I've called you to. Yes, you can in me, says the Lord, in me, if you allow my love to work in you, to perfect you, to make you complete and whole in me, yes, you can. I didn't call you to do something you can't do, but it's through me. So he's still crying out, do you love me? Wisdom cries out, do you love me? Then listen, 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 listen to me. Read my word. Don't be like the Jews of old that literally tied it on a parchment around their arms and in their head. Bind your word to my heart, to your heart. Let it reside there deep within your heart. There you will find peace. There you will find joy. There you will find righteousness and purity and holiness in my word, says the Lord God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. How do you hunger? How do you thirst? If you want to feel that sensation of hunger, you're going to stop eating. You stop eating long enough, you're going to be hungry. Are you thirsty? Because if you're not thirsty, stop drinking. You stop drinking long enough, you'll become thirsty. Now that's naturally speaking, but what I'm talking about is, are you hungering? Are you thirsting for the living God? Why did the Israelites have to go through the wilderness? I ask these questions, and if I continue reading the word, I usually, most all the time, get my answer. It says in Deuteronomy 8:2, and you remember all the ways which the Lord thy God led thee these 40 years in the wilderness to, there's the answer, humble thee, to prove thee, to know what was in thine heart. Not that he needed to know what was in my heart. You need to know what's actually in your heart. So stop running away from the wilderness, because sometimes it's in the wilderness that you find the living waters from a rock. Sometimes in the wilderness where there's this bitterness of waters, a tree will come in there and make it sweet to you. We can't keep running away from these things. There is a purpose in the calling, and sometimes the calling, there's suffering and there's pain, but never more than you can bear. He said, I will not leave you. I will not forsake you. Every time you felt you were alone, I was there with you. I was there shadowing you. I know you didn't see me. I know you didn't sense me. Nevertheless, my word is true. I will never leave you. I will never forsake you. I was there. Because they went through the wilderness to find out whether they would keep his commandments or not. We were struggling today. We were tired. It's the middle of the week. We were exhausted. And the Lord wants to know, are you going to let that get in the way of me and you? Not that you couldn't have stayed home and had this marvelous, glorious presence with the Lord time, but you came tonight anyway. So we know that the wilderness experience represents a time of testing. It's also a period of what I call detoxification. You know, when there's a alcoholic that just needs to detox, or there's a drug addict that is just, he's just got to detox. He's got to stop cold turkey drinking or smoking or whatever drug that he's on. The wilderness experience is our detoxification treatment center from the world, from the riches, from its pleasures. Because the Israelites got out of Egypt, but what is the word said that Pastor Joe echoed and that I probably said it at other times? But Egypt never got out of them. They were still hooked on the pleasures of Egypt, and the wilderness experience was a way to get it out of them. And they fell in unbelief and stayed there, but the next generation was able to get out and go forward because they weren't addicted like they were to the ways of the world. They remembered the fish that they ate in Egypt, the cucumbers, the melons, the leeks, the onions, the garlic. But now our soul is dried away, they said. There was nothing at all beside the manna before our eyes. He was literally feeding them day after day after day, faithfully for 40 years, 40 times 365. I can't think of how many days that is, but it's a long, long time. And after 40 years, they still wanted Egypt. Then Egypt they got. The things that we lust after, the idols that we have that are left unremoved from our heart or unrepented of from our heart, led to their death and will lead to ours if we don't deal with that. It's why fasting is so important. It causes you to hunger. It causes you to thirst. And the question is, where will you direct your lust or your hunger or your desires when that thirst arises in you? Solomon, my son, it says in 1 Chronicles 28:9, know thou the God of thy father and serve him with a perfect heart. and with a willing mind, for the Lord searcheth all the hearts. He understands all the imaginations of the thoughts. If you seek him, he will be found of thee. If you seek him, he will allow himself to be found by you. That's a promise. If you seek him, he will allow himself to be found. That doesn't mean it's going to be immediately. That doesn't mean it's going to be within a minute, within an hour, within a few days, within a week. If you seek him, he will allow himself to be found of you. So seek him. Seek him with all your heart. But the opposite is true. If you forsake him, he'll cast you off forever. That's not my words. That's right there in the words. 1 Chronicles 28:9. So why did I start this whole teaching about love? And now I'm talking about fasting. If you don't give up and put away all of your lust and your idols and fast from all that which comes between you and the Lord, you will not understand and you will not appreciate the depths of his love for you. You won't get there. It won't mean much of anything to you if you don't do that. Because either you're going to give your love to other things or someone else, or you're going to give your heart over to the Lord. Will you stand with me? Let's pray. I don't have much more to say. Heavenly Father, I am so privileged and honored to be able to be used by you to speak unto your people a word of encouragement. Father, I just pray that they have heard your word of how much you love them, how much your heart aches for them, just desires them above anything else, Lord Jesus. But Lord, I also hope that they've heard how demanding your love is, how much you require of us. And if we love you, we will walk in your ways. We will walk in your statutes. We will walk in your word. We will not turn from the right or to the left, but we will turn our faces a flint to you, Jesus. And as we keep our eyes focused on you and yield to where you're leading us and guiding us by the compass that is within us, that is your spirit, you will bring us to completion and perfection in the day of Christ Jesus. That glorious day that you have planned for all of our brothers and sisters, for all the saints from eternity past to the present and into the future. You've got a plan for good, not to harm us, to give us a future and a hope. Father, give us grace in that wilderness, that detoxificated atmosphere, Father, so that we can get rid of the things in our life that are just impeding our growth in you. They're impeding our listening to you. They're distracting us. They're leading us to the right and to the left, Lord. Help us, Jesus, to keep our eyes focused on you. And as always, deal with us according to your loving kindness and your mercy. Because if you dealt with us according to how we deserved, we'd be in hell right now. So, Father, do not remember our sins against us. But, Father, thank you that your tender mercies are renewed for us day by day by day. Every day we can wake up and say, thank you, Lord, that your tender mercies renewed for me again. Just repeating your word to you. Oh, God, that's how we hide your word in our heart. That's how we combat the lies of the enemy, the thoughts that keep coming. It is written. It is written. It is written. We speaking. It is written. The Lord loves us. The Lord will never leave us. He will never forsake us. If we hold fast our confidence in him. So Father, help us to do that. Help us to just exercise our faith to go stronger and stronger in you, pressing into you more and more each day, Father. Help us not get distracted by the daily activities that we have. We all have them. And I'm the first and foremost that just gets so distracted because I'm just about business and getting the job done. And then, at home is where I got to relax and I can refocus again. But thank you, God, that you're walking with me throughout the day. Thank you, Father, that we can pray without ceasing throughout the day, into the night. Even in our dreams, we could be praying, God. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Continue to lead us by your Spirit, Father. Teach us, Father, to just be attentive to your voice amidst the chaos of the day. Help us to be attentive to your voice. Help us to recognize the open doors that you set before us, the avenues of ministry about speaking to someone, sitting next to someone, praying with someone, just talking with someone, spending time. Help us not to get distracted by responsibilities and remember that every moment is a moment of ministry because we're allowing you to live your life through us. You purchased this with a price. We recognize it. We acknowledge that. And so the best thing we can do is present ourselves as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable. That is our reasonable service for all that you've done for us and that you continue to do. So, Father, prepare the way before everyone as we end this week. Re-energize them that we're exhausted, that we're fatigued in coming here. Father, focus their minds, focus whatever's been distracted in their emotions, in their body, Father. Align them according to your kingdom alignment that we would finish this week strong and we would come on International Sunday and glorify you. Let all the nations, tribes, and tongues come in one mighty voice and glorify the name of our Lord Jesus. And all the saints said, amen. Good night, y'all.